प्रताप सर, गुड मॉर्निंग।
मॉर्निंग सर, मॉर्निंग।
ठीक अच्छे।
नमस्कार सर।
हाँ सर, नमस्कार सर, जॉइन करना था ना।
सर अभी आज तले।
ओके ओके।
आज अच्छा दी सर, अच्छा दी।
हाँ सर, अच्छा लाइन अच्छा। म्यूट कर चुके। ମ୍ୟାଡ଼ାମ ଆପଣ ପିଲାମାନଙ୍କ ସହିତ ଇଣ୍ଟରାକ୍ସନ କରିଥାନ୍ତୁ, ଆଉ 2 ମିନିଟରେ ଆମେ ଷ୍ଟାର୍ଟ କରିବା।
আচ্ছা ঠিক আছে স্যার। হ হ স্যার হ মু স্বাগত কর দউচি কথা কে হলা ম্যাডাম। সর্বেভ্যঃ নমো নমঃ। সম্মাননীয়া সরিতা পূজারী মহোদয়াঃ, সরিতা পূজারী ম্যাডাম মহোদয়াঃ, সম্মাননীয়াঃ অত্যন্তন অতিথি অধ্যাপক বিজেপি স্বয়ংশাসিত মহাবিদ্যালয় সংস্কৃত বিভাগস্য সহচার্যাঃ ডাক্তার মধুসূদন মিশ্র মহাভাগাঃ তথা ওড়িশা রাজ্য মুক্ত বিশ্ববিদ্যালয় সদস্য শ্রদ্ধেয় ছাত্রাশ্চ। अहम संस्कृत विभागस्य शैक्षिक परामर्शदात्री डॉक्टर सूर्यकांति प्रधान सर्वेषां एतद् ऑनलाइन पाठ्यक्रम मध्यम स्वागतं करोमि। अद्य शिक्षादानार्थम् अस्माकं समीपे उपस्थिताः सन्ति अस्माकं पूर्वपरिचिताः बीजेपी स्वयंशासित महाविद्यालयस्य सहचार्याः मधुसूदन मिश्र महाभागः। तान् महोदयान् वयम् ओडिशा राज्य मुक्त विश्वविद्यालयस्य एतद् ऑनलाइन पाठ्यक्रम मध्यम द्वितीयवारं स्वागतं कुर्मः। ते महाभागः अस्माभ्यं भारतीय भाषा परिवाराणां विभाजन विशेषतादिषु विषयेषु पठयिष्यन्ति। भाषायाः विज्ञानं भाषा विज्ञानं विशिष्टं ज्ञानं विज्ञानं भाषयति जा सा भाषा भावविनिमयस्य प्रमुख माध्यमः भवति भाषा। जगतः सर्वाणि कार्याणि भाषया संचालितानि भवन्ति। ज्ञान विज्ञानस्य धर्म दर्शनस्य आचार विचारस्य च मूल आधारः भाषा एव अस्ति। तथा च उक्तम् न सो अस्ति प्रत्ययो लोके जाह शब्दानुगमाद्रुते अनुविधमिव ज्ञानं सर्वं शब्देन भासते। अर्थात यदि भाषा रूप जति ही न स्यात् तहि समग्रं त्रिभुवनं अंधकारं गहरं मध्ये निमज्जितं स्यात्। अतः अहम् समयस्य अपचयं न कृत्वा तान् महाभागान् अनुरोधं करोमि। ते महाभागाः अस्मभ्यम् एतेषु विषयेषु शिक्षादानं कुर्वन्तु इति डाक्टर् मधुसूदन मिश्र महाभागम् अहम् अनुरोधं करोमि एतद् विषयेषु अस्मभ्यं शिक्षादानं कुर्वन्तु। जो सान को कहूं तो अनम्यूट कर म्यूट कर देवे देवी देते सर। हेलो जो सान को
सुदन सर अपन का माइक टा म्यूट हो ची अनम्यूट करो तो
सर कौन रिपोर्ट ले सर
कट्टी गल कट मो फोन करी कोच मैडम।
हाँ फोन 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 कर कोई दिन
हेलो
सर सर प्रणाम सर।
ठीक है तो
हाँ सर सुबुद्धि सर।
फ्रेंड्स आज आई हैव ऑलरेडी डिस्कस्ड इन द लास्ट क्लास लैंग्वेजेस ऑफ द वर्ल्ड आर डिवाइडेड इनटू डिफरेंट ग्रुप्स एंड देयर एंड अकॉर्डिंगली we have two different types of divisions classifications. We have morphological classification, which is in called in Sanskrit as akruti mulakam vargikaranam, and we have genealogical classification paribarikam vargikaranam. All languages evolved in the course of time from a common source language constitute a language family. Though varying from one another in their present forms, such languages evince their genetic kinship in several ways. They have a common stock of base words with resemblance in form and meaning. For instance, Indo-European languages possess in common similar words of family relationship like father, mother, etc. This morphological classification is based on words and syntax, padarachana and vakya rachana. and this padarachana and vakyarachana, they formulate, they form the external form of the language. In the second group, we have genealogical classification, which gives emphasis on the meaning. You know, all the languages of the world have been divided into four major types. We have isolating or ayogatmaka. We have agglutinating or yogatmaka. Then we have inflectional, slishta yogatmaka, and we have praslishta yogatmaka or incorporated languages. Under the genealogical classification or parivarika vargikarana, we have 18 languages in total. Out of the 18 languages, we have 10 languages under the Eurasian, 3 under African, 4 under Pacific, and 1 under American subgroups. As you know, the various languages spoken all over the world today number around 6,000. According to the 2007 census, the number is 6,912, including 516 languages which are going to die very soon. They are facing extinction. Though varying in forms, these languages are broadly classified into two different ways based on their formal and familial resemblances. The formal classification, known as a morphological classification, or rather morphosyntactical classification, takes into account the form of words combining into sentences along with their syntactic relationship for giving rise to a particular meaning. When words are combined together and formed into a sentence, that finally gives us a definite meaning. This form of classification admits four major types of languages, namely isolating, incorporating, agglutinating, and inflectional languages. These are the morphological classifications. Now we have the genealogical classification. Genealogy means vamsanucharitam. Basing on the family, you know, just as the kids of a particular family have common traits, common features, common language, common genesis, common growth. Similarly, those languages which have similarity with regard to their words, morphology, whether syntax or vakyarachana, whether meaning or semantics, those languages are grouped under genealogical classification. And under genealogical classification, we have four different subdivisions, and there are in total we have 18 language families under the genealogical classification. As I have already told you, under the Eurasia, Europe and Asia, we have 10. Under the African subhead, we have 3. Under the Pacific, we have 4. And under the American, we have 1. So in total, we have 18 type languages. Under the Eurasian subfamily, we come across the Indo-European family. We have Indo-European, Dravidian, Burushaski.
Hey, Pigli. Ala Saulo Dhara Hukila.
Ural Altai, Chinese, Japanese, Korean, Hyperborean, Basque, and Semitic Hamitic. So these are the 10 languages which come under the Eurasia subgroup. Under the African, we have Sudanese, Bantu, Hottentote, and Bushmen. Then under the Pacific or Prashant Mahasagariya, we have Malay Polynesian, Papuan, Australian, and Austroasiatic. And under American, we have only one American. What are the basis or basis, so to say, on the basis of which, what are the factors on the basis of which this general classification has been made? We have four, what is the basis of this general classification? We have four different bases: proximity of place or region, sthano samipyam. Then that means generally those languages which are spoken in a particular region come under that group. Then we have similarity of words and meaning. We have shabda samya. Then we have grammatical similarity, vyakaranagata samya. And we have phonological similarity, that is dhvani samya. So what is the importance of then this Indo-European family? As you know, Indo-European family comes under the Eurasia family. So the language which is spoken in the entire Asia and the Europe, some part, major part of Europe, are grouped under the Eurasia subgroup of the geological classification. So we have why Indo-European family is so much important in linguistics, because it has the highest number of users. Number one is highest percentage of the population of the world use this language. Then we have the highest geographical expansion. These languages occupy a very great extent of the geography of the world. Then with regard to literature, excellence in literature, excellence in culture, with regard to the excellence in literature, culture, linguistics, scientific excellence, and political affairs, these languages of the world, of this family, have the highest excellence in the world. Then linguistics or comparative philology cannot begin without Indo-European family of languages. We have given four different names this family. Indo-European family is also known as Indo-Germanic family. It is also known as Aryan family. It is also known as Indo-Hittite family. But finally, the Indo-European name has been accepted by one and all, and this is in the current nowadays. You know, whether or not, we are not sure from which common source this Indo-European family has come from. You know, the number of language families of the world cannot be precisely stated because of our want of comparative language knowledge of all existing languages of the world. The German linguist Wilhelm von Humboldt from 1767 to 1835 AD, who carried on research on the Basque language family spoken in parts of Spain and France, considered the number to be 16, while Frederick Max Müller assumed it to be 100. However, most of the scholars of our time speak of 18 major languages coming under the family of the world. Friends, it is very difficult to say with definite or definite certainty. Indo-European constitutes a family of which it is considered of us as the parent and primal ancestor. Theoretically accepted, Indo-European is an unrecorded, hence hypothetical language believed to have been in use among the people of a single race living in a single region more than 5,000 years ago. It is believed by linguists that the languages coming under Indo-European family must have come from a common source. And what is that common source? The common source has been named as Proto-Indo-European sounds. Proto-Indo-European European language is the stock from which all Indo-European languages have come from or developed or evolved. The concept is the result of the concept regarding original Indo-European sounds is the result of the intellectual exercise of some linguists. When did it begin? In the second quarter of 19th century AD, the exercise began. Basis means, what are the basis of believing that the languages coming under Indo-European family have come from, have evolved, have born from a single source? The similarities that is found in Sanskrit, Greek, Latin, and Avesta. We have tremendous similarity with regard to the word morphology, syntax, vakya, semantics, arthatattva. Among the most ancient languages of the world, such as Sanskrit, Greek, and Latin, and to some extent Persian or Avestan. So that gave us the impression that Indo-European families of languages have born from a single stock. It is for the first time in 1870, Professor Ascoli made an exercise. He thought that the original Indo-European ka sound does not change in some languages and remains as ka, whereas it changes to sa, palatal sa, talabya sa in some languages. To clarify, he chose the word that stands for 100. For 100, the Latin word is centum, whereas in Sanskrit it is satam. So where in Latin it is ko, pronounced as ko, in Avesta is satam, in Sanskrit is satam. So he thought of the possibility that since in out of the 10 languages, I give you the list. In Sanskrit we have satam, in Avesta we have satam, in Persian we have sado, in Hindi we have sou, in Lithuanian we have simtam. These are the languages under the satam group where ka sound changes to sa. On the other hand, there are another six languages where they remain unchanged. In Latin we have centum, Greek ekton, Celtic ket, Tocharian kand, Gothic hund, German hundot, the French kent, Italian kento. So for 100 we have two types of words. In one group that ka sound remains unchanged as ka, and on the other hand in some languages that ka sound changes to sa.
So that prompted Ascoli to believe that perhaps these languages have come from a common source, and that common source is known as original Indo-European or Proto-Indo-European. The Proto-Indo-European ko sound remained as ko, remained unchanged as ko in some languages, and it changed to palatal so in some other languages. So that is the basis from which he believed. He could not prove, it is believed. So whether there was a language called Proto-Indo-European is not known to anybody. It is simply the result of the linguistic exercise of some of the scholars of 19th century AD. So under the Indo-European family, we have 10 languages. We have Indo-Iranian or Aryan. We have Balto-Slavic. We have Armenian. We have Albanian. We have Greek, which is also called as Hellenic. We have Celtic, Germanic, Italian or Italic, Hittite, and Tocharian. As I have told you, the concept regarding Proto-Indo-European sound is the result of the intellectual exercise of some linguists of 19th century. The basis was the similarities with regard to morphology, phonology, syntax, and semantics between Sanskrit, Greek, Latin, and Avestan other languages. So, after that exercise, they decided that what are the form of that original Indo-European? They told that in the original Indo-European, we had three series of vowels. We have Hrasva vowel, we have Dirgha vowel, and we have Udasana vowel. Hrasva was O, A, and O, Dirgha was A, A, and O, Udasana Swa, S, C, F, W, A. Swa. We have Sanyukta Swara, A, E, A, U, A, Ru, A, Ru, An and Am. We have A, E, A, U, A, Ru, A, Ru, N and M. Similarly, O, E, O, U, O, U, On, On and Om. Then we have Dirgha Santa Sara, similarly as in Hrasva Santa Sara, the Antastha Sara, E, U, Ru, Ru, Na, and Ma, the Antastha Banyana, Ya, Wa, Ra, La, Na, Ma. So we have pure Banyana or consonants, three series are found. Generally in Sanskrit we see we have Ka, Cha, Ta, Ta, Pa, five vargas, five series are not found in original Indo-European. Original Indo-European has only ka, ta and pa. Cha, ta, these two series were not found in original Indo-European. So we have three types of ka sounds. We have ka, kha, ga, gha, pure vowels. Kya, kya, gya, gya. We have kanta talabhya. The kwa, kwa, gwa, gwa, the kanta ostya. So in the ta varga, we had ta, tha, da, dha. Pa varga, we have pa, pa, ba, bha. For sibilance or usma varna, we have only sa, with the dental sa. So now, basing on the sound change of original Indo-European, linguists divided the Indo-European family into two groups. We have Satam group and Kentum group. He thought the original Indo-European word was Kamtum, K-M-T-O-M. K-M-T-O-M was the original word from which the word Satam and kentum have come from. The original kamtum changed to satam, S-A-T-E-M, and kentum, C-E-N-T-U-M. The original Indo-Brahman family of languages, the Indo-Brahman family of languages was infectional. I shall give you the basic features, the important features of original Indo-European languages. Friends, as I have already told you, the original Indo-European family of languages gave rise to 10 languages coming under the Kentum and Satam. The what is the important feature, or what are the important features of Indo-European family of languages? First is, it is Shlishta Yogatmaka or inflectional. Initially, or in the beginning, the words were these languages were synthetic, but afterwards they became analytic. What is synthesis and what is analysis? See, I give an example in Sanskrit, Balakam. In Balakam, the am suffix, am pratyaya, is so well mingled in Balaka, it cannot be differentiated. Balakam is a single word. But when you go to Hindi, you tell Balakko. So Balak is the word, Ko is the, Balak is the stem, Ko is the suffix. So here it is analytic. Balakaha patati, Balakam pathayati, Balak ko padhata hai. So Balak and ko, the stem and the suffix, these are separated. So from synthetic to analytic. The number two, with regard to morphology. What is the morphological importance? If you go to the Sabda Ratana, all words are formed with a stem and a suffix, with a root and a suffix. These roots can be two of two types. We can have Krudanta and Tadita. We have primary suffixes and secondary suffixes. In the primary suffixes, we have a root and a suffix. Bhu plus ta bhuta. In tadita, we have a word plus a suffix. Bhuta plus ika bhutika. So we have two types of suffix addition. We have primary suffix addition and secondary suffix addition. Then, in the Indo-European languages, almost all roots were a monosyllabic, ekakshara dhatavah asan. Almost all dhatus were of one syllable, monosyllabic roots. Then, with regard to the upasargas were originally or initially independent. Now, we cannot have upasarga in Sanskrit. They are not used independently. Upasarga ha kriya yoge. No upasarga can convey meaning without being attached to a root. Pra is a word, pra is a pradi or gati, which cannot be used independently. You have to prakarsaha, prakamaha. So you have to attach it to a particular root. Prakru, prakrushtaha. So originally, the upasargas, but originally these upasargas are independent. If you go to the Veda, you say Haribhyan, Jahi, Oka, A. If you make the Anvaya to Haribhyan, Ajahi, Oka. Ajahi Here I is separated from Jahi. I has a separate, it is an independent existence of its own. But later on, when we come to the classical Sanskrit, see, no upasarga is used independently of a root. Clear? Now, it is also believed that upasargas had independent meaning, but nowadays upasargas do not have any independent meaning. They simply change the meaning of the root. Suppose achara achar, vichara vichar, sanchara sanchar, prachara prachar. In all these words, roots remaining same. Root is the same, char. But when the upasarga changes, the meaning changes. Upasarga na dhatartha balat anyatra niyate. Because of the addition of the upasargas or prefixes, prefix. Upasargas cannot be attached afterwards. They have to be attached before, pre. So upasargena dhatvartha badat anyatra niyate, the meaning of the roots are forcibly changed because of the addition of upasargas. Now, if when you come to the syntax or vakya rachana, initially, in the beginning, all sentences were formed by combining different terms and not words. No sentence can be formed by joining words. You have to form sentences by joining terms. Padanang sanyogena dakshajana bhavati na shabdanang sanyogena. Tadat asyartat bhavati yada shabdehi sakam vibhaktayah युज्यन्ते तदानीमेव तेषां व्यवहारः वाक्य भवति न सर्वेषां न कदाचित् स्वतन्त्राणां शब्दानां प्रयोगः क्रियते वाक्ये. नाउ विथ रिगार्ड टू द अनदर इम्पोर्टेंट फीचर ऑफ इंडो फैमिली वी कम अक्रॉस द प्रिवेलेंस ऑफ समास और कंपाउंड. With a view to delete the case endings or vibhakti of many words, and many actually compound is always done between two words. So if you have more than two or you have 20 words, we have to first join two, then two, then two, then make one compound. So samasa or compound formation is one of the most important features of Indo-European family of languages. Then we have vowel gradation, which is very important. Vowel gradation or apashruti. In the original Indo-European language, because we had udatta accent, we have swarabheda, guna, vriddhi and dirgha. In the Indo-European languages, the original Indo-European prefixes, suffixes were deleted. So I shall give you the example of vowel gradation. Suppose drink. Drink becomes, if you change the I of drink, it becomes drank. Then if you change the I of drink to U, we have drunk. Drink, drank, drunk. Ring, riang, wrong. Same in Sanskrit, deva, the A changes to I, daiva. Vidhi, E changes to I, vaidha. Kumara changes to kumara. This is how, with the addition of different suffixes, we have formed the vowel gradation. Then, we have pratyadhikya, we have plenty number of pratyayas or suffixes. These are the 10 most important features of Indo-European family of languages.
as I have already discussed earlier, we have several language families under the Indo family. We have Farsi, Indo-Iranian or Aryan language family. Then we have Balto-Slavic, which is also called Leto-Slavic. Then the third one is Armenian, fourth is Albanian, fifth is Greek, sixth is Celtic, seventh is Germanic or Teutonic, eighth is Italic or Italian, sometimes are called Roman, then ninth is Hittite, tenth is Tocharian. 10, Tocharian. Now, with regard to the first one, Indo-European family, Indo-Iranian family or Aryan family, why it is called Aryan? In my last class, I had told you that Aryan, the word Aryan, is of great antiquity. The present Iran, the word is the state Iran in the western part of Indian subcontinent, the Iran is a corrupt form of the word Aryanam. Iran is sabdaha, Aryanam is the sabdat vitpannaha. Asyartha bhavati Arya jatiyaha tatra mulataha prachin Iran deshe asan tasmat vasthanat paravartani kale te bharatam agatavanta iti kechana vadanti tatra visambado vartate. This Aryan or Indo-Iranian family is again divided into two. We have Indian and Iranian groups. In the Indian, we have the Vedic Sanskrit and the classical Sanskrit. And on the Aryan, we have Vedic Sanskrit and the classical Sanskrit. And on the Iranian, we have the Avestan language. Friends, if you make a comparison between Sanskrit and Avesta, I have already told you Avesta means the foundation text or basic text of the Persian people. On that, in my first class, I had given you an idea about the similarity between Avestan and Sanskrit languages. Specifically, if you make a slight change of the words in the Avestan languages, that becomes Sanskrit. I had recited a verse from the Yasna. We have asambohu bahistam asti usta mai bahistam asai. This is how you can change Avestan gathas, so Avestan mantras into Sanskrit slokas without any difficulty. Just as we have three different stages in Aryan, old Indo-Aryan, Middle Indo-Aryan and New Indo-Aryan or MIL. Similarly, in Iranian, we have three different stages. We have Old Iranian or Avestan. Then we have Middle Indo-Aryan, Middle Iranian, which is Pahlavi. And we have Modern Iranian. We have Pashto, Baluchi, Pamiri, Kurdish and Persian. The ancient literature of Iran was very extensive and very rich. But however, due to several external aggressions, certain attacks, most of the rich literary treasure of ancient Iran has been lost to us forever. Two times attempts are made by different external forces to completely destroy the literary output of ancient Iran. In 331 BC, the first attempt was made by Sikandar. And whatever was left after that attack, the Sasanian kings, they protected, preserved those literature with all sincerity. But when Khalifa al-Mutbakil in the year 847 to 861 made another attempt on Iran, it completely destroyed the residual literature. And whatever has been still left, that has been collected in Avesta. Ancient Iran had two main languages. One is Eastern Iranian, which is called Avestan, which is the religious text of the Parsis. The Parsis also called it Avesta. Avesta or Avesta. The language is Avesta, A-V-E-S-T-A. The name of the religious text is Avesta. The script is also Avesta. But in case of Sanskrit, the name of the text is Veda. The language is called Sanskrit. The script is called Nagari or Devanagari. But with regard to Avesta, the same name is used for the text, religious text, the same name for the script, and the same name for the language. Just as the word chandas also applies to Veda and the Vedic language, similarly, Avesta stands for the religious text as well as the language. Just as we have different commentaries on the Vedas, Vyasanacharya, Ubhata, Mahidara. Similarly, we have commentaries on the Avesta called Jend, Z-E-N-D. If you translate Avesta Jend to Sanskrit, it will be Chandas. Sanskrit Chandas, Avestan Jend. So that without understanding the meaning of the word Jend, many people erroneously, wrongly call the text as Jandavesta, Jandavesta. Zarathustra was the, Zoroaster or Zarathustra was the writer of the Jandavesta. So what does the word Avesta stand for? Avesta means the basic text or the upastha, the basic text. So Jandavesta is a wrong name, but some people still call it. The time of Avesta is 700 BC. This is all about the Eastern Iranian. Why I give you such a comprehensive knowledge of Iranian language? Because you have some idea about Vedic language and the classical Sanskrit language, but we have no idea about Iranian language. So Iranian language, ancient Iranian had two subgroups. We have Eastern group and the Western group. The Eastern group is called Avestan language. Then in the Western group, Western Iranian is called ancient Persian or old Persian. Kurus was the founder of the Achaemenian Empire. Kurus, K-U-R-U-S-H, from 558 to 533 BC. He was the founder of the Achaemenian Empire, in ancient Persia. So he had left some inscriptions, Abhilekha. After him, Darius I, Darius, Darius I, from 522 BC to 486 BC, he had also left some inscriptions called the Behistun inscriptions. These famous inscriptions are still preserved in Iran. From the study of these two inscriptions, Kurus inscription and Darius inscription, we get some idea about the ancient Persian language, which is a part of Paschim Irani or Western Iranian language. That was the this Western Iranian language was the Rajabhasa. That was the court language during the reign of Darius I. So far as antiquity is concerned, Prachinata is concerned, this Western Iranian language evolved a little after the Avestan language. But with regard to syntax, semantics, morphology, and phonology, it has tremendous similarity with that of the Avestan language. Then in the Middle Iranian, we have they also called as Achaemenian Farsi, Achaemenian Persian. The old Iranian has two. We have Purbi Iranian, Eastern Iranian, Western Iranian. The Eastern Iranian is called Avestan. The Western Iranian is called Kurus or Old Persian. The Middle Persian is called Pahlavi, Pahlavi language. Pahlavi evolved during the 3rd century BC. Ardashir was the king during whose reign this Pahlavi language developed like anything. The literature of Pahlavi began from 3rd century BC. It has two different subgroups, Hujwares and Pajand. Hujwares and Pajand. Then we have the modern Persian. So the old Persian had, old Iranian had two. We have Eastern Iranian preserved in Avesta, the Western Iranian preserved in the inscriptions. Then we have the Middle Iranian called the Pahlavi. Then we have the New Iranian, which is synthetic. New Iranian is the national language of modern Iran. You know, Firdausi, the time is 942-1020 AD. Firdausi had written the Shahnama. Shahnama is the initial text written in, the first text written in modern Persian. And that is why Shahnama is the national epic, Rashtriya Mahakavya of modern Iran. We have very less number of Arabian words in Shahnama. However, modern Persian has embraced, has amalgamated many Arabian words in it. In modern Persian, we have almost 70% Arabian words. modern Persian is written in Arabian script. Its literature is very rich. Then in modern Persian, we have many dialects, just as in Sanskrit, in Odia, we have different dialects. Dialects are spoken in a confined region. If you make a comparative study of Odia languages spoken in different parts of Odisha, if you go to Brahmapur, you have different type of Odia. If you go to Balasor, you have different type of Odia. If you go to western part of Odisha, we have it is almost influenced by the coastal language, the Rajanandagaon area. Then we have the Nuapada area. It is more Chhattisgarhi. It has a different type of annotation. It has a different type of connotation. Similar Odia words, suppose you see the word for gudi, for English word kite, the standard Odia word is gudi, whereas in Kostli or Sambalpuri, the gudi means a temple. So similar words have different meanings. So these are called dialects. Dialects are spoken with different meanings and with a difference of geographical variation. So similarly, modern Persian are different dialects. We have four different. We have Pashtunian, then Baluchi, then Pamiri, and Kurdish. These are the four different major dialects of New Persian. Now, if you go to the difference between Avesta and Sanskrit, we have to give two different accounts. We have the similarities and the dissimilarities. As you know, in India, Sanskrit is the oldest language. Its ancient most form is found in the Vedic Sanskrit. Similarly, in Iran, the oldest language is Avesta, and its oldest form is found in the Avestan religious text. As I've already told you, Sanskrit is the language, Avesta is the language. Veda is the text, Avesta is the text. Nagari is the lipi or script, Avesta is the script. There is no change with regard to script, name of the text or the language in Avesta, but there are three different forms with regard to the language, three different names with regard to the text name, name of the text, name of the language, and name of the script. Avesta is believed to be a correct form of the word avastha, which means vyavasthita. Some people called Avesta has come from the word upastha. Jain is the correct form of the word, or a parallel form of the word chandas, which means commentary, tika, or vyakya. Whereas the commentary on the Veda is written in classical Sanskrit, the commentary on Avesta is written in Pahalavi. So commentary along with the text, it is wrongly called as Janda Avesta by some people. Now, I give you three examples of Avesta which can be translated into Sanskrit. Bispa Duksha Janaite. If you translate into Sanskrit, Bishwo Durakshyo Jinvati. Bispa Duksha Nasaiti विश्व दुरक्षो नश्यति यथा हानोति ऐशम वाचम यदा श्रुणोति एताम वाचम. सो दिस इज हाउ यू कैन मेक विद स्लाइट इफर्ट यू कैन ट्रांसलेट द वैदिक संस्कृत इनटू अवेस्टर्न संस्कृत. एज यू नो द ओरिजिनल इंडो यूरोपियन लैंग्वेज हैड थ्री बेसिक वोवेल्स अ ए ओ but these three basic vowels have merged into one in Veda and Avesta. Originally but yukos a Latin yukos Sanskrit aswaha avesta aspo nibhas nabaha nabo apo apa apa means jala yag yaj yaj to sacrifice. Then we have a swa, I have told you, we have Udasana swara, old, original Indo-European or Proto-Indo-European pate, in Greek it is petar, in Latin it is petar, P-A-T-E-R, in Sanskrit it is pitar, in Avesta it is pitar, pitra. Then we have the kabarga, I have all told you, we have three different types of gutturals in original Indo-European or Proto-Indo-European. We have ka, kha, ga, gha. All these change into one ka in Veda and Avesta. Then in both Veda and Avesta, in the with regard to the Ajanta Sabda, the words ending with a o. In the sixth Bahuvachana, sixth case ending plural, we have Nam Pratyaya. Balakanam, Devanam. In the Lotlakara, Pratham Purusha, we have two Pratyaya. Gachatu, Patatu. Then, just how we have Sabdarupa in Sanskrit, in Avesta we have also Sabdarupa. We have eight karakas, karta, karma, karana, adhikarana, sampadana. We have eight karakas, including sambodhana. In the Sanskrit, similarly, we have three vachanas and three lingas. All these are available in Avesta. With regard to the karaka prayoga, we have tremendous amount of similarity between Avesta and Sanskrit language. Suppose Sanskrit ekaha, dau, trayaha, chatvaraha, pancha, avesta eka becomes ayeva, dau becomes dva. Even dva, we have a dva word called dva in the Veda. Dva, supatna, sayuja, sakhayaha, samana, prukshyam, parishaswajate, tayo, ranyaha, pippalam, swadbatti, anasnam, anyo, abhichakasiti. So dva word meaning two is found in both in Veda and in Avesta. Avesta for eka ayeva, for dva, we have dva, for Sanskrit trayaha, here you have three, for Sanskrit chatvaraha, they have chatvara, for Sanskrit pancha, they have pancha. Then we have hapta, for sapta, they have hapta, then for naba, they have naba, we have bingsati, they have bishati. We have Trinsat, they have Trisat. We have Prathama, they have Phatama. We have Dvitya, they have Vitya. We have Tritya, they have Tritya. We have Turjya, or Chaturtha, they have the Turiya. Then, with regard to the pronouns, Sarvanama, in most of the cases, we find similarity between Sanskrit and Avesta. Ismad, Asmad, similar, they have. For aham, they have ajam. For mam, they have ma. For mat, they have mat. For Sanskrit me, avesta me. For Sanskrit tum, avesta tum. Hindi also it is tum. For Sanskrit tvam, they have tvam. Ta becomes tha. For tvat, they have tvat. Tava, tava. With regard to vachya, tense, kala, mood, late lakara, prayog, etc. It is almost similar to Vedic Sanskrit. we have forms like with tumun and lap, gantum, patitva, agatya. Similarly, they have ti, he, me. Just we have 10 ganas. We have in an avesta, we have 10 ganas in avesta. Just as we have Sanskrit, we have 10 ganas, they have also 10 ganas. We just have a bikarana, they have also bikarana. Plus, bhavati, bhu, ati, bho, ati, the kartari sub comes, or becomes inside, or comes inside. So we have similar bikarana in avesta and Sanskrit. For a parokya bhuta, we have litlakara. Similarly, in avesta, for a parokya bhuta, they have also litlakara. We have dadhara, they have dadhara. Then, just we have mantras, they have gathas. In avesta, Sanskrit, and satur pratyaya, we have tlap pratyaya. Similarly, they have also tumun, dhyayi, dhyayi, ase, ase. Different types of pratyaya are also found. Just as in Vedic mantras and avesta gathas, the chandas are also the meters that are used in both Sanskrit and avesta. In avesta, the meters are very similar to Gayatri, Anutup, Trishtup, and the meters are of immense similarity between Sanskrit meter. We have in the Yasna, Yasna refers to a part of the avesta. The Usnabaiti Gathas are written Trishtup Chanda. We have 5 padas. In each pad, we have 11 varnas. So this is how we see we have different types of similarities between Vedic and Avestan Sanskrit. With regard to the dissimilarity, we have also much difference between Avestan and Sanskrit. Matra. See, with regard to the swara matra, we have different dissimilarities. Suppose Sanskrit atha becomes atha. Sanskrit rutum becomes ratum. Ru is a dirghati ratu. For swa, for Sanskrit a, we have swa ardha swara there. Santi, hanti. H with swa nti. Sanskrit a changes to oe in avesta. Sanskrit veda, avesta vaeda. Sanskrit o becomes o, hota, jhota. Sanskrit a and o becomes a. Suppose Sanskrit devaihi becomes Daibahi. Sanskrit gauhu become gaus. In avesta we have swara bahulya. We have 8 swaras in avesta. Sanskrit has only a and a, as it is the 2 similarities. Then Sanskrit a, o, a, o changes to oe, oo, ae, and au in avesta. Sanskrit ru changes to ar, or only ra, or la in avesta. Krunoti, karanaoti. Then epenthesis. Epenthesis means apanihiti. Is a very major characteristic feature of avesta. If apinithi means, suppose bhavati, another vowel is inserted inside. Bhavati becomes a bhavaiti. So E, the vowel, is inserted between Bhavati, Bha and Ti. Then Rinakti, Irinakti, E comes inside. Sanskrit Ka Ta Pa changes to Kha Tha Pa in Sanskrit. Sanskrit Ka Ta Pa sound, K T P, change to Kha Tha Pa in Sanskrit. Kratuhu becomes Kratus. Sanskrit Satya becomes Haithyo. Sanskrit Swapnam, Huapnam. Sanskrit Swapa becomes Khwava, Pa becomes Ba. Sanskrit Gha, Gha, Dha, Bha becomes Gha, Dha, Bha. KTP changes to KH, TH, PH. Similarly, Sanskrit Gha, Dha, Bha, GH, DH, BH change to GDB. Jangha becomes Janga, Gha becomes Gha. Sanskrit Soma, sorry, Sanskrit Dharayat becomes Dharayat, Dha becomes Dha. Sanskrit Bhumi becomes Bhumi, Bha becomes Pa. Similarly, Sanskrit is Sa. We have Talabhya Sa, Dantasa and Murdhana Sa. Talabhya is called palatal, Dantasa is called labial, and cerebral is called Murdhana Sa. I am talking of Dantyasa becomes changes to Ha. Sindhu becomes Hindu. Asura, Ahura. Soma, Homa. Sapta, Hapta. Saptaha, Hapta. In Sanskrit also, in Odia also we call it Hapta sometimes. In villages, the Saptaha becomes Haptaha. Then Sanskrit Ha becomes Ja. Hurdaya, Jaradaya. Sanskrit Hasta, Jasta in Parsi. Sanskrit Swa, Talabhyasa Va, becomes Pa. Viswa, Vispa. Aswa, Aspa. In Sanskrit, in Cha Varga, we have five letters. Cha, Cha, Ja, Ja, Ya. But in Avesta, Cha Varga, only Cha and Ja. Cha, Ja and Ya are absent. Sanskrit has a different burger, new burger called ta burger. Ta, ta, da, da, na. These ta burger letters are absolutely absent in Avesta. Then, so far as nasal sounds are concerned, anunasikya dhana yaha. In Sanskrit, we have ya, ma, ng, na, na. The ya and na, they are not in Avesta. They have ma, na, and ma. Sanskrit has a law sound. That law sound is absolutely absent in Avesta. It changes to ra in Avesta. The fourth letters, ka, kha, ga, gha. Gha is the fourth letter. The gha, then gha, jha, dha, dha, bha. These five sounds are absolutely absent in Avesta language, which are present in Sanskrit. In Avesta, the last Swaravarna vowel is lengthened. Asura becomes Ahura. Asi becomes Ahi Dirga. Then, Ekakhara Nipata, monosyllabic Nipatas are lengthened. Nu becomes Dirganu. Pra becomes Phra. Then, Antima Ma. If preceded by EU, then they become Patim, the Paitim. This is how they have tremendous amount of similarities as well as dissimilarities between the Sanskrit language and the Avestan language. These are all about the major important branch of Indo-European language. We have discussed about the original Indo-European language from which Indo-European family has come from. Then I have already discussed about the other branches. We could not discuss on that day about the major branch, that is Aryan or Indo-Iranian. This today we decided to discuss about the Iranian branch, the other important branch of branch is Aryan. We have three different branches, three division, time divisions. We have old Aryan, old Indo-Aryan, we have Middle Indo-Aryan and New Indo-Aryan. In the old Indo-Aryan, we have Vedic Sanskrit. In the Middle Indo-Aryan, we have the classical Sanskrit. And in the New Indo-Aryan, we have the modern Indian languages. In the Middle Indo-Aryan, we have three different stages, from 500 BC to 100 AD, from 100 AD to 500 AD, from 500 AD to 1000 AD, we have the Middle Indo-Aryan times. Pratina Sanskrita, which is called Pratina Prakrita, or Pali, or past Prakrit. Then we have second Prakrit, then we have third. This is how, as you know, in the second Prakrit, we have Maharashtra Prakrit, we have Saurasani, we have Magadhi, we have Paishachi, we have Ardha Magadhi, we have Udraja. Different Prakrits are there. You have to, in the, as we have discussed with regard to the old Indo-Iranian, old Iranian, Middle Iranian, and New Iranian, similarly, we have discussed the old Indo-Aryan, Middle Indo-Aryan, and the New Indo-Aryan. Just as we have given it, given an example about the difference between similarity and dissimilarity between Vedic classical Sanskrit and classical Sanskrit. Similarly, we have Vedic Sanskrit and Avesta. Similarly, we have to discuss about Vedic Sanskrit and classical Sanskrit. This is another important question we have to go through. How Vedic Sanskrit changes to classical Sanskrit? Suppose Vedic Sanskrit has a law. Sanskrit, classical Sanskrit doesn't have a law sound. Rusura has present in Vedic Sanskrit. Rusura is almost extinct in classical Sanskrit. Vedic Sanskrit has three different accents, udatta, undatta, swarita. Classical Sanskrit doesn't have udatta, undatta, swarita. Then we have Rasa, then a Pluto. In classical Sanskrit, we don't have Pluto. So another important question we have to discuss about is the similarity and dissimilarity between Vedic Sanskrit and classical Sanskrit. Similarly, we have three different stages of Middle Indo-Aryan. The first one is first Prakrit or old Prakrit or Pali. Then second is we have the importance of Pali language. Then we have inscriptional Prakrit. Then in the Madhyakalina Prakrit or Middle Indo-Aryan, we have second Prakrit. We have different Saurasani, Maharashtri, Magadhi, Ardha Magadhi, Paishachi. These are the Prakrit languages. Then we come to the third, that is the Aparamsa, Pratutya Prakrit or Aparamsa Prakrit. Then we come to the Adunika Arya Bhasa, Bharati Arya Bhasa. You know, all Indian, all modern Indian languages, MIL, have come from the third Prakrit or Apabhramsa. Saurasani gave birth to Eastern Hindi, Rajasthan and Gujarati. Maharashtra Prakrit gave birth to Marathi. Then Magadhi gave rise to Bihari and Bengali, Odia and Assamese. Ardha Magadhi gave rise to Purbi Hindi, Eastern Hindi, and Paishachi gave to Lahada. Then Brachad gave rise to Sindhi and Punjabi, and Khasa gave birth to Pahari. This is how the modern Indian languages have been created. Now, if you have any question, we can discuss. I invite the question from the students.
Hello, sir. Chatranam kati prasnaha prichanti jatha nabanika jena sa prichati bharatiyo upasakhayaha visaya vadantu.
Bharatiyo upasakhayaha.
Agya, sir.
Indo-European has 10 branches. Out of those 10 branches, I have already given you the idea about the 10 branches. We have Indo-Iranian or Aryan language. We have Balto-Slavic, Armenian, Albanian, Greek or Hellenic, then Celtic, Germanic, Italic, Hittite, and Tocharian. These are 10. Out of the 10, we have the Indo-Iranian or Aryan family. I have discussed in detail the three different stages of Iranian branch. We have Old Iranian, Middle Iranian, and Modern Iranian. Similarly, Aryan has three different branches, three time divisions. I've already discussed it. We have Old Indo-Aryan, Middle Indo-Aryan, and a New Indo-Aryan. Old Indo-Aryan is Vedic and Classical Sanskrit. Old Indo-Aryan, Vedic and Classical Sanskrit, up to 500 BC. Then we have Middle Indo-Aryan. We have Middle Indo-Aryan. In the Middle Indo-Aryan, we have three stages. First Prakrit, second Prakrit, and third Prakrit. First Prakrit is called first Prakrit, second Prakrit, and third Prakrit. Third Prakrit is called Apabhramsha. Third Prakrit is called Apabhramsha. You go from the modern to the ancient one. That is up to 500 AD to 10,000, 500 AD to 1,000 AD. 1 minute. Okay, we have three divisions. We have Old Indo-Aryan, Middle Indo-Aryan, and New Indo-Aryan. Old Indo-Aryan is up to 500 BC. Then we have first Prakrit, under the Middle and Indo-Aryan. Under the Old Indo-Aryan, we have Vedic and Classical Sanskrit. In second phase, we have Middle Indo-Aryan. It has three divisions, three time divisions, from 500 BC to 1000 AD. This is called Ancient Prakrit or Pali. Ancient Prakrit or Pali, time is 500 BC to 100 AD. The second is Middle Prakrit, 100 AD to 500 AD. Then we have third Prakrit called Apabhramsha, from 500 AD to 1000 AD.
Hello.
Hello.
हेलो हाँ सर द्वितीय प्रश्न पृछति मूलो भारतीय भाषाया मूलो सरोह कति विद्यम अस्ति
हाँ वी हैड थ्री डिफरेंट टाइप्स ऑफ आई ऑलरेडी टोल्ड यू वी हैड थ्री डिफरेंट टाइप्स ऑफ वी हैव बेसिक वोवेल्स थ्री टाइप्स ऑफ बेसिक वोवेल्स ह्रस्व अ ए ओ दीर्घ आ ए ओ एंड उदासीन Basic, three basic vowels. O-A-O, Raswa. A-A-O, Dirgha, Udasana Swa. Then we have Sanjukta Swara, Similarly, we have Dirgha variety. The antastha swara e u ru ru nama, then antastha banjana yabara la nama. Pure banjana, I have told you, in Sanskrit, we have kacha ta tapa, but ka tapa, these were there, cha and ta are absent in old, in original Indo-European. Clear? Hello.
Sir, tritiya prashnam. Whitney Mahadhan, language is study, iti pustake kim likhitam asti?
Yes,
sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
भारोप्य परिवारस्य जनसंख्या सर्वोत्तमा भवति सर्वेषु अधिका भवति
हां
तला बिकम द फैमिली यूरेशिया द एंटायर यूरोप एंड द एशिया दीज आर द बिग टू दिस आउट ऑफ दीज आर द टू बिग कॉन्टिनेंट्स इन व्हिच दीज लैंग्वेजेस आर स्पोकन इंडो यूरोपियन फैमिली हैज द हाईएस्ट स्पीकर्स ऑफ स्पीकर्स इन द एंटायर वर्ल्ड
अन्य एक प्रश्न पृच्छति मूलो भारतीय भाषायाः ध्वनिनां विषये ध्वनिनां विषये
बारंबार कुतो कथितं वदतु
हां सर
मय ध्वनिनां विषये बारंबार कुतो अधुनैव कुतो उक्तम
हां सर
बेसिक भाग
हां कोन
बेसिक भाग यत् संस्वर देन दीर्घ स्वर दंतस्थ व्यंजन एंड क वर्ग त वर्ग एंड प वर्ग उष्म
सर समय तो सारी आसले से सर बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद धन्यवाद हा मान्य हा
डॉक्टर वी हैव स्टिल मिनट
वदन सर
यदि कस्य कश्चन प्रश्न वर्तते पृच्छतु
नहीं सर इति ही थिले इति प्रश्न ही थिले हां सर सेते भवत भूव भ कर्तव्यम ओडिसा राज्य मुख्य विषय ओडिसा राज्य मुक्त विश्वविद्यालय पक्षते ह धन्यवाद ह ग्रामपयामी सर भूय भूय धन्यवाद
भवतीनां कृते सरिता पुजारी महोदयानां कृते मेयर महोदयानां कृते विश्वविद्यालयस्य अन्ये जे अधिकारिणां वर्तन्ते तेषां कृते अपि मम हार्दान् कृतज्ञतां विधिवेदयामि
थैंक यू सर पुनः भवन्तं अहं अन्य एक पाठ्यक्रमे भवन्तं मां डाकिबु सेपि बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद समस्त सर आपन को धन्यवाद भी दै
छथिं
छात्र माने
जति लेख्य गुटे पढियो परि माने लेख्य गुटे पढे न लेखा दै पारु नै
आज्ञा सर
साउंड गुडा के पिला जानि पारंती स्वामु कहू उल्टा ईटा लेख्या पडिवो
हां सर सेटा गुटे पीपीटी कर देले पीपीटी प्रेजेंटेशन दे देले से लेखा राखी शो करिवो पीपीटी प्रेजेंटेशन हां दे देले शो करिवो सारा दे लेखा देखाई के पिला पढी करे
बहुत आडो सारा ओडिसा रुजन ना हां
हां सारा ओडिसा रे सर
हां सारा ओडिसा रुजन
आ गया सर
टेक्निकल पाटे तो इंडोर भलो मत आपण इंडोर पण कहले कारण पिलांग मु कारण कहले से जो आर्यन फॅमिलीटा बुझी परिय वेदिक शास्त्र कसे असन कहि देली किंतु ईरान नंबर के जान नथिल से माने अवस्था से जानि आ मते किछि वेद अवस्था तुरंत पढियो गटे
सर जेति भी आज आपण कले बहुत भलो पिला माने बहुत उपकृत होइतिबे आ बहुत पिला माने आपण को धन्यवाद दै छथि जते को पिला सब क्लास अटेंड कर छथि सर थैंक यू सर थैंक यू वेरी मच सर ओके सर
मैडम डिस्कनेक्ट हुआ।